I would say one thing that I think the biggest mm-hmm. difference is, do we see cuisine or culinary as a culture or as tourism?
Mm.
It should be under culture.
Mm-hmm.
Every Taiwanese should learn Taiwan flavor history.
Mm-hmm. Good local time, everyone, and welcome to the latest episode of Innovative Minds with Audrey Tang. To date, we've met innovative minds in the fields of politics, research, and the defense of human rights. But today, we're going to enjoy a more sensory experience with Taiwan chef André Chiang. Local time, everyone, and welcome to the latest episode of Innovative Minds with Audrey Tang. To date, we've met innovative minds in the fields of politics, research, and the defense of human rights. But today, we're going to enjoy a much more sensory experience with Taiwan chef André Chiang. André was born in Taiwan and grew up around the Shilin night market in Taipei City. After choosing to follow in the footsteps of his mother, a hard-working cook versed in all manners of cuisines, he chose to move to France, as French cuisine was for him the most untouchable. Now, André's philosophy is based on modernizing the classic French techniques by sourcing the most fresh and the most interesting seasonal produce. Having made an indelible impression on the culinary scene since opening Restaurant André in late 2010, the popular establishment was ranked 14th on the world's 50 best restaurants list in 2017 and held its spot for 7 consecutive years. Please join me in welcoming today's guest, André.
Hi, Audrey. Hi, everyone. This is André.
Hi. André, I knew that you entered the culinary scene very, very early on at a very tender age. At what moment did you suddenly think, oh, I love cooking, I want to be a chef?
Oh, first of all, my mom was a chef, so I kind of started very young by helping out my mom in the kitchen. Mm-hmm. And that's, I guess, where it starts or plant a seed of me being a chef. But since I was a kid, I think my mom has planned to train me to become a chef. Uh-huh. So we always have this little game of guessing what's inside mm-hmm. of whenever we go to a restaurant. So we will guess what's in the dish. And mm-hmm. I think for me, that's kind of competition because I'm a competitive person. So kind of a game between me and my mom.
Mm-hmm.
Every time we go to a restaurant, and that kind of planted the seed of me, I want to be a chef, and I want to learn more about culinary so I can do better in the next challenge with my mom. So I will try to eat as much as I can. Oh. I try to order different type of food,
mm-hmm.
To learn different spices and vegetables,
mm-hmm.
so next time I can have better guess whenever we play the game, what's inside. Yeah.
Well, that sounds very interesting. Yeah. And was there a particular dish that you made that you started your career?
Well, I think, I can't recall, but the first dish that I did it myself was mm-hmm. Was a ketchup fried rice.
Okay.
Yeah.
Sounds delicious.
that's where I first started learn how to cook. You know, put a chair in front of the wall because I was too little.
Mm-hmm.
So I think I started cooking since I was 8
wow.
or 9.
Mm-hmm.
But officially when I was 13. But I think what means to me about cuisine is whenever we learned a dish, or my mom took me to try a dish in a restaurant, then she will do it exactly the same dish again at home and then tell me how to make it better. So my mom dish always better because she dissect all the process and then tell me that if we make one little change and this dish tastes better, no? I say, yeah, it tastes better. Then I will take that dish. She will put that dish in the lunchbox and I bring it to school. I always have two lunchbox. One is for myself and the other one is to share with my classmates. That's what my mom taught me. Good food is to be shared. So I always have two lunchbox and one is for myself and one is for my friend.
I guess that would have made you really popular. It tastes good.
Yes.
But not long after that, since you mentioned that you officially became a cook around 13, but you moved abroad just 2 years afterward at 15. Yes. So what motivated this move to France?
So at the beginning, I decided to leave Taiwan when I was 13, and I went to Japan to help my mom in the restaurant. She had a Chinese restaurant there.
Okay.
So I was helping her for 2 years. But, you know, the Chinese culture of learning, especially, you know, learning how to cook in the kitchen is quite different. It's almost like how we teach a kid, you know, this is what we should do. Don't try to be funny. And you just do what I said.
Yeah.
Never
Lots
ask,
of discipline.
Never ask questions.
Yeah, that's right.
Just yes, and you do it. And then while I was in Japan, that was the year that Fuji Television started to have this Iron Chef program. And when I saw this Japanese Iron Chef that cooked French cuisine, that really amazed me. How could an Asian chef cook such a beautiful, tasty French cuisine? So I say, I told my mom I want to be a French Iron Chef. So yeah, and that's that kind of direct me to being a French chef. And also, while I was selecting my path, whether I should continue of cooking Chinese cuisine or I should learn Japanese cuisine since I was in Japan or French cuisine, because I think that's the three best cuisine in the world for me at that time. And so French cuisine is always so far away and it seems to have so much imagination of that culture. So I told my mom I want to learn French cuisine and I want to go to France. And yeah, and then I go when I was age of 15. I don't know much about it, but that was this motivation of being a French Iron Chef at the age of 13.
Did you learn French before going to France?
No, I don't.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, but I do. I recognize all the menus and recipes because I read a lot. I read a lot, especially, you know, French cuisine, French chef. I remember when I arrived, before I arrived in France, I bought a book. It's called 100 Best Chef Portrait in France. So I can flip on any page or any portrait of the chef. I know his name, his restaurant, where it is, the specialty of the restaurant, and how many Michelin stars he got. So I was obsessed in French cuisine before I even go there. So the basic ingredients, cooking methods, I know it before I go. Yeah.
So you immersed yourself for like 10 years, right, in the French culture. So how was life like as someone who is obsessed with French culture but have not previously been in France?
I will say it's painfully beautiful.
Okay, painfully beautiful.
I didn't bring anything with me, so the life was tough. I was just living with a farmer he gave me a room. I don't have any money. Mm-hmm. So I asked my chef that where shall I live? So he let me stay in his house for about a month. And then after that, he recommended me to a farmer that produced the vegetable for our restaurant. So I stay in a barn house that is super cold in winter, that is extremely hot in summer. That's where they park the, all the machinery, the barn house for free. The only thing that I have to do is I have to wake up at 3 o'clock in the morning. So I'll help the farmer to flip the pumpkin, to cut the aubergines and tomatoes, whatever that is ripe, that is ready to go for market. Then I put it on the trolley so he can arrange nicely, so he can push that cart to the market. That's the only thing I have to do to pay my rent. So that's how I started. So basically I wake up 3 o'clock in the morning, and after the farm work, I'll go to the restaurant. Then I finish about maybe 12 midnight, So you got 3-4 hours to sleep every day.
Well, it sounds pretty painful. So what's the beauty part of it?
As I'm so obsessed in French culinary, I think every day I open my eyes, I want to work. And as I mentioned, I know every best chef in France. So I know that I'm living in a fairy tale. And all the people that I saw in the book, now I'm talking to the person, I'm working with the chef, and then I'm working on the dish that I used to see in the book or magazines, and now I'm living it. So it's a beautiful process. I never feel that a day of exhaustion or tired or pressured. Of course, there was pressure, but I'm happy. I lost 17 kilo the first 2 years because it was too tough. But I was happy. My mom wanted me to quit because I was like a skeleton. And then I said, no, mom, I was happy. I'm very happy to be in that environment, to be a great chef. So yeah,
that's the beauty of it.
That's the beauty of it, yes.
So one thing that I noticed, and the media also noticed, is that you love collaboration with artists of all different sorts, multimedia artists. How did that come about?
Well, I think to create is one thing. To deliver an experience is another thing. So as an artist or artisan, we have that creating process. But after you create your masterpiece or something that you would like to express, how to connect to the audience, it's a different part of art. And I think every creator has the same vision of delivering messages. And the only difference is the medium, whether I did it through food or through painting or through sculpture. In fact, we're doing the same thing. So I naturally feel very easy to speak to artists, very easy to communicate with them. And I think to deliver a message or deliver an experience is not only through food, but the sound, the visual, the, you know, the five senses. That's where I feel there's no difference, there's no boundary for me to work with different artists, you know, across industry.
Are there particular early experiences of such collaborations when you were in France or even before?
I think in France, it teach me how to appreciate beautiful things in life. I still remember when the first year I was in France, and my chef took me to the market, and they say, I'll show you the market. I say, okay, we're gonna go buy this, buy that. And we went to a vegetable stall, and the vegetable was beautiful, the aubergine, everything was so fresh. And then he told me, pick one. And so I picked the aubergine. So he said, how you want to cook it? Mm-hmm. I say, I don't know. You tell me. Because when I was in my mom's kitchen, mm-hmm. it was never like this. They would just do it, cut it this big, mm-hmm. and then do as I said. She doesn't want me to have mm-hmm. any thought mm-hmm. passing my mind, try to cook it like this or that. So it's the first time people ask me, how do I feel about the vegetable? How do I want to cook it? Mm-hmm. I start to appreciate beautiful things. The second is I learn how to express my emotion mm-hmm. Through food. So I guess that was a very big change since I was a kid. I was 15 at that time. So that changed the relationship for me. Oh, finally I can express myself. Finally, I can tell people what I think and how I want to cook it. So I guess that's a very big difference. Maybe the education mm-hmm. In France compared to mm-hmm. Asian
education. A lot more creative freedom.
Yeah, it is. It is. Mm.
Did you make a distinction between calling yourself an artist or artisan?
Yes.
Is there a difference?
Definitely. Mm-hmm. A lot of people think that we're artists, but I said no. We're not an artist. We're an artisan. Mm-hmm. What is an artist? Artist for me is you can have a free imagination, free creation of anything that you want to do, mm-hmm. without even have a purpose.
Like unconstrained.
Exactly. Uh-huh. But an artisan is sometimes has to be very scientific, mm-hmm. very calculative, mm-hmm. and yet creative. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. For example, I always said that to build a Ferrari, it's an artisan. Mm. Not only it's an art form, it's a beautiful car, it also has to go fast. The same thing for a chef mm-hmm. is we're not only present the food as beautiful as it should, also it has to taste good. Mm-hmm. So we kind of have to balance that. One side you have very sharp, calculative taste bud, and yeah, the other side you have to let your mind go mm-hmm. To be creative, to be imaginative. Mm-hmm.
Right, so imaginative engineering profession, something like
exactly,
that.
Yes.
Disney used to call that imagineering. I
yes.
think that captures the artisan spirit.
Yes.
All right, so we'll take a short break and then we will be back to talk about your growth and social engagement. And we're back. So, André, there was a critically acclaimed film in 2021 called André and His Olive Tree that beautifully captured everything about your life and everything you do in Singapore.
Yes.
But it included this moment in your life when you decided to return to your cuisine, like original intent, the beginner's mind, to engage the people in Taiwan and build a local talent system to the French standard. When did you become interested in such social engagements?
Well, first of all, I think it started maybe 10 years ago mm-hmm. When I first decided to write my first bio, mm-hmm. Cuisine. Mm-hmm. I still remember at that time when people were saying that, oh, Andre, you should come back to Taiwan now. The food and beverage industry is booming and there are more and more schools. They're mm-hmm. having food and beverage management. Then we have people having international win the international competition. Mm-hmm. But I saw something that I pretty concerned is that we shouldn't teach our young kids to, I call it gamble. Mm-hmm. We shouldn't teach our young kids to become an athlete that go for a competition mm-hmm. and wins awards and expect that it could be successful mm-hmm. overnight.
I see.
It's accumulation of experience and understanding of any industry or any craft. Mm-hmm. It takes time. I never been through any competition. I never won any awards mm-hmm. or a medal. Mm-hmm. So for me to be who I am today, it's a lot of, like I said, a lot of accumulation of experience and hardship mm-hmm. to get there. So mm-hmm. that pushes me to write my first bio, Cuisine, to share with everyone that I'm just a simple guy. I was born in Taiwan and in the night market. I like what I do. And it just consistently believe what you do and consistently accumulate all that experience will make you who you are. Don't think about just betting your time to win a competition mm-hmm. and expect that will change your life overnight. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So that's where I think when I first started, and at first I feel that I probably could do something to change the idea or the conception of the young generation. And more and more after my first restaurant, Restaurant Andre, I start to understand that there are a lot of Asian chefs that really look up to what I do. And so that gave me a more responsibility to show them what is the right thing to do. Or being an Asian, and you will find most of our young kids, they won't tell you that I want to be Gordon Ramsay, mm-hmm. but more they want to tell you that I want to be Andre Chiang.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Because that is something that they feel mm-hmm. attached to, and then they feel that being a Taiwanese, I can cook a great French cuisine as well. Mm-hmm. I can be known internationally as well, as long as I work hard. So I guess that pushes me to work towards how to influence and make a difference to our industry mm-hmm. in a different way, through education, throughout the new concept or the new topic for us to discuss. Yeah, I guess that was the beginning, how my initiative.
Mm-hmm. And so last time we met, it was a year ago, right? You mentioned one of your projects, your ongoing projects,
yes.
To build such a fresh perspective yes. on the kind of work that you and other Taiwanese chefs do
yes.
together. It's called the Taiwan Taste Book,
yes.
Which is a way for you to introduce the Taiwanese cuisine to the world. And
yes.
I find it very interesting because although I eat those sort of food like literally every day, it's not very well known internationally. When I go to international conferences, people know bubble tea, xiaolongbao, and that's pretty much it. Right. You introduced me to these ideas of like the sanbei, the three cups, the salty and crispy yansu, and so on, are distinct Taiwanese flavors. What did you want to achieve with this project internationally? And why call it the Taiwan Taste Book?
Okay. Taiwan Weipu, we officially call it Taiwan Flavor Spectrum.
Flavor Spectrum.
Yeah.
Okay.
So Taiwan Flavor Spectrum is, for me, it's the DNA of Taiwanese flavor. Mm-hmm. It is a book. Mm-hmm. It's a material I think we should have it in the school mm-hmm. for everyone to understand what is Taiwanese flavor. And also, I think it's a tool for us to introduce ourselves internationally. I guess when I always said to be able to think out of the box, you have to stand outside of the box. Mm-hmm. And then you look, I've been standing outside of Taiwan and look inside of the box, what do we have and what's missing. I realized that we enjoyed our own cuisine, our own flavors so much, mm-hmm. but most of the time we felt hard to explain mm-hmm. who we are,
yeah.
what we eat and mm-hmm. why.
Yep.
So having a lot of experience, seeing that in China, they have a flavor book about Sichuan cuisine, mm-hmm. The flavor spectrum. Mm-hmm. In France, we have, I call a La Rousse. Mm-hmm. It's a dictionary of traditional flavors, how it combined together. But we don't have such a foundation to teach our young generation or to introduce to other culture that this is what we do. That for me is something that I think is the one thing that I want to achieve, and also one of the reasons I decided to come back to Taiwan, and it is an ongoing process. So we start to have this Taiwan Flavor Spectrum Lab early this year. Mm-hmm. So it's already, we start to accumulate a lot of data, and hopefully we'll start to have something interesting to show everyone.
Excellent. So yeah, last time we talked about analyzing historical texts.
Yes.
And making sure that when people use different words, they actually mean the same flavor.
Yes.
And things like that. And I think it's a really, really interesting research topic. So what are the differences that you see when running a restaurant or a lab in Taiwan compared to your other experience, which has been running in France or in Singapore? Are there cultural differences of running such projects or coordination or kitchen here?
To run a restaurant, I think the biggest difference is it's almost no marketing mm-hmm. in Singapore or France. Mm-hmm. Yeah, just people doesn't need, and mm-hmm. everyone knows exactly mm-hmm. what they want. And compared to Taiwan, mm-hmm. a lot of marketing, branding need to be done to communicate with the public. I think that's quite a big difference. Mm-hmm. To run in a lab or what we do, doing a research of a flavor, I think in France or in Singapore, we're slightly more aggressive than in Taiwan. Mm-hmm. I would say the government is slightly more aggressive. We have a department in the government that focusing on culinary, either in France or in Singapore. I think that's very important. Mm-hmm. If you see, I will say one thing that I think the biggest mm-hmm. difference is, do we see cuisine or culinary as a culture or as tourism? Mm. It should be under culture. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. It should be a department mm-hmm. under Ministry mm-hmm. of Culture.
Right, and not just tourism.
Yes. Mm-hmm. So I think maybe at the beginning we put it mm-hmm. at the wrong file, and then that file should go to a different way. So currently how we work on culinary, it's more tourist driven uh-huh. or how to entertain uh-huh. Instead of going deeper into a cultural research. Uh-huh. That I think it's a big difference. And I was in a member of a culinary department in Singapore mm-hmm. and also in France. Mm-hmm. So since we don't have that department, I feel that it is important for us to have. And then if we have that department, Taiwan flavor spectrum is definitely in there,
because
That's part of the cultural project.
Mm-hmm. What else would you put in there in addition to the spectrum?
Well, I think that's the first thing, because every Taiwanese should learn Taiwan flavor history.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
We should all know more about the history, the past 100 years or past 200 years of Taiwanese culture and mm-hmm. how the flavor evolved, as well as our Taiwanese history. It should be in the book. And then all the culinary students, they should learn our Taiwanese flavor formula before mm-hmm. we learn how to cook French or Spanish
or cuisine. Yeah.
Other cuisine.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. So I think that's that probably is the first priority.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And apart from that, there are so many restaurants or cultural activities involved. For example, when I was in Singapore, I represent Singapore to Paris
mm-hmm.
to cook in the embassy of Singapore for all the ambassadors coming from around the world
mm-hmm.
to show Singapore cuisine, which doesn't make any sense. I'm Taiwanese.
mm-hmm.
So, but I was the best chef in Singapore at that time, the best restaurant in Singapore. So, but I mean, so it, culinary is the best tool for us to show who we are, our identity. And because the flavor is so distinctive and so precise that we can even tell people that we are different from anyone else,
mm-hmm.
not from the look, not from the skin color, mm-hmm. not from the language, but through our food.
Mm-hmm.
We can tell people that we're different from anyone else. It's a gentle way to tell who we are.
Mm-hmm.
And it's very easy to connect to anyone around the world through food. So I guess we have a long way to go.
Right, so it's not at the periphery of culture like tourism, but at the essence
exactly.
of culture.
Exactly.
And you've been like internationally, not just in Singapore, France, and Taiwan.
Mm.
I understand you've also been in Africa.
Yes.
and in restaurants and all over Europe as well.
Yes.
And you actually work with TLC, the channel,
yes.
on this series of visits to countries around the world to
yes.
explore the essence of culture, that's food, around the world. What have you learned from this very international experience?
Yes, talking about the TLC program,
mm-hmm.
We call food in our time.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, it's my last project before I leave Singapore.
Mm-hmm.
I want to create a program that about food, but not showing everyone where to eat, how's the food taste like,
mm-hmm.
or travel around the mm-hmm. world and then see beautiful mountains and the rivers.
Mm-hmm.
But really go deeper.
Mm-hmm.
But having said that, it's a boring topic, and there's actually no such a TV program that talk about food in that direction.
Mm-hmm.
And being as a chef, I feel it's something that I want to do whether people like it or not. So mm-hmm. I actually write the script of the whole thing.
Oh.
And then
your
I pitch to
proposal of the producer. Right?
Yes.
Oh wow.
Yes. So I did the whole proposal
mm-hmm.
and I pitched it to TLC, and then they like it very much. And that's how we started to really see food in a different direction through heritage, through tradition, nature, mm-hmm. or humanity. It sounds heavy, but actually not. Do we know where cuisine come from? A group of people, they live in the same place, and then the spring, summer, autumn, winter, the issue reflects from where they live, mm-hmm. how they survive, and how they enjoy food. Mm-hmm. And that's cuisine. Mm-hmm. But cuisine can be decided by nature. Mm-hmm. Some cuisine are decided by nature. For example, the place that I went is Siberia. Mm-hmm. That's the coldest place on the planet. It's minus 72 degrees.
Wow.
Mm-hmm. So the nature decide how the cuisine will look like. I was in Ghana. They don't have a cuisine. In Ghana, they have a very broken culture, so it was very tough. Everything is different. If you go one city to another city, they will tell you different things. What is Ghana? Mm-hmm. What is the Ghana cuisine? No one says the same thing. So it's very broken culinary culture. But the people, they collect word of mouth. They collect all those alphabet and try to put them together. So what made the cuisine of Ghana is human.
I see.
They collect those bits and pieces, mm-hmm. and then they put it together and they say, this is our cuisine. So, and in China, it's different. China is tradition. So we inherit those 1,000 years of knowledge and technique, and it, you know, we inherit and we continue of doing it. So cuisine being defined in a very different way, some through human, some through nature, and some are heritage. So that's what I feel it's interesting as a chef to show people what food is like in my perspective. Mm-hmm. So yeah, I'm a complicated person sometimes.
I think you've made an excellent case why this should be administrative culture, not tourism.
Thank you.
Because it sounds like culture to me.
Yes.
So in this generation, we've seen that many chefs are not as traditional or just following one particular tradition, as you just mentioned, as they used to be. They're very vocal, socially engaged, believe in cause about human rights issues, artistic coordination, all sort of different flavors of chefs. What do you think is the reason of such a vibrant culture of a new generation of chefs?
First of all, I think our industry has evolved so much. Mm-hmm. Before, we probably have 30%, I'm talking about the last generation, mm-hmm. probably have 30% of the time that we dined out. And nowadays, I would say even 70-80% of the time we dined out,
yep.
instead of cooking in. So what we eat, 80% decided by the chef.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Mm-hmm.
So the chef decide to use organic vegetable or they decide to use processed food, mm-hmm. that directly affect the citizens' health. So that's where I think it's important. And secondly, nowadays chefs, they're not only just cook. Sometimes they need to be farmer.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
You understand the change of four mm-hmm, seasons. Mm-hmm. You understand of when to eat what. Sometimes you have to be scientist,
mm-hmm.
Nutritionist.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So I guess the requirement of being a chef is getting more and more. That's why I've been teaching in a couple of university in Taiwan for 7 years now.
Mm-hmm.
I don't teach them how to cook. I never pick a pan or a fork to show them how to cut a fish or cook a rice. I teach them color. I teach them four season. I teach them sometimes branding, strategy, mm-hmm. calculation, creativity, which I think nowadays in the new generation mm-hmm. of chef, what they should learn Sometimes we even just talk about advertising, talk about branding, trend, color, brand, luxury brands, how they market themselves and what intrigue your eyeballs, which I think they're all relevant today for a chef to learn. So probably we got the toughest job among all.
Yeah.
Because you don't just need to learn one thing, you have to learn basically everything.
So the nature of becoming a chef is becoming complicated.
Exactly.
Yeah, so it's not just you. It's complicated. The entire field is becoming multidisciplinary.
Yes.
Is what I hear.
Yes.
So so the last question for this segment, it's been reported that you returned your two Michelin stars and you declined to attend the Michelin Award ceremony, making a stunt and preferring instead an award with an open and also more democratic judging mechanism on the social aspects of the food industry, such as Asia's 50 best restaurants. So please tell us more about this choice, like why?
Okay. If I can make an example, that what if the Olympic game only have one sport.
Ah, okay.
How's it gonna be like? It's gonna be crazy.
Mm-hmm.
And currently in a culinary world, we only have one sport.
I see.
It's Michelin Guide.
Okay.
Nothing wrong with it. But if we only have 100 meter race, and then we have someone who jump really high. We have someone who's, you know, swimmed really fast.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, like asking a fish to climb a tree.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's not going to work. So there are so many great restaurants, great chefs. There are, the weather, it's a food stall or... there's Spanish food, Chinese food, in different form of culinary. I think they all deserve their own spot. And while you have one criteria for everybody, sometimes it's different. It's very hard to judge whether it's good or not good.
Mm-hmm.
So... For raw, I think it's a different animal. The reason that I created raw 8 years ago is I think Taiwan need a platform. Taiwan need to have its own brand. Like Ding Tai Fung is the Taiwan brand.
Yeah.
We tell everyone that they know
yeah.
Ding Tai Fung is Taiwanese. They know raw is Taiwanese.
Yep.
So it's a platform that we show all the beautiful things that we have in Taiwan in a different form of art. And so it's very hard to be calculated or to measure how many stars you want to give. Well, I think we should get 5 stars.
Yes.
For the purpose.
Every other field has 5 stars.
Yes. For the purpose of... You know, or the for the intention of why we're having this platform, not for how fast you can run or how elaborate or you know crystal chandeliers and white gloves and silver cutleries. That's one of the reason that I think it's every restaurant should decide whether they are going for. 100 meter race or not, or they can join other things.
Yeah, with their own mission, purpose, and impact.
Yes, and it should not be compulsory. We should not have only one sport with one criteria, one standard. That should be
plural.
Yeah. Yeah. So that's what I think. And for restaurant Andre, it's slightly different. The reason I returned the Michelin star because you know, I grew up with it. I grew up in that Michelin culture. I never work in a restaurant that is not Michelin-Starred.
Oh, wow. Mm-hmm.
All my restaurant that I work in France is 3 Michelin-Starred. Mm-hmm. I work in all the best 3 Michelin restaurants in France.
Mm-hmm.
So it's in my blood. To receive such a high accolade, at the end of my restaurant, I would like to return. It's like you receive a precious gift from someone, and one day if you don't need it, you return it instead of throwing it away or in other use. So I think to return the Michelin-Starred is a right gesture.
Mm-hmm.
I return a precious accolade, which I think I might not need it in the future. Yeah.
Okay. So you're making a statement, but it's a friendly statement.
Yes, you can say that.
Cool. Okay, so after a short break, we'll be back and talk more about the next generation. And we're back. Andre, you've mentioned that you wanted to work with the Taiwanese talent and the next generation.
Mm.
I've heard that you've got a really young team, yes. Like just early 20s or something.
Yes.
Please tell you how you did this.
That was the since the beginning, we decided to have an 100% Taiwanese ingredient restaurant.
Mm-hmm.
So our team is part of our ingredients essence.
I see.
So we have a very young team, an average of 25.
Mm-hmm.
In total, we have 50 staff.
Okay.
For a restaurant, it's huge.
It's
almost
huge.
A baseball team.
I know.
So manage a such a huge team, I think the biggest challenge for us is to really give them a guidance of what's the motto for this restaurant.
Mm-hmm.
We're not only a restaurant that cooking French-style cuisine with Taiwanese ingredients, but also every time we try to deliver a message, try to find our own DNA a little bit more. I think for this 8 years, so we come up with our own philosophy of communicating with this young generation and our own philosophy.
Mm-hmm.
First is we call the yes mentality.
The yes mentality.
Yes, just when every time we come up with an idea, we'll say yes.
Ah, okay. Like can do,
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
So we first try it, but we will say, yes, I can do it, but I will need his support.
Mm-hmm.
I will need, instead of saying, no, I cannot do it because I didn't have this, I didn't have that, or it's, you know, it's too time consuming, etc. So we will say yes. So yes is our yes mentality.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, I will need 3 weeks to finish it.
Okay.
But I can do it.
So it's a yes and that, not yes but.
Yes. Yes. So, and that that creates a different atmosphere when we discuss about concept and project. Second thing that we develop is I spend a lot of time sharing or communicating concept instead of telling them what to do. Every season we have a different concept, or you know, the restaurant has its own rules and regulations, but it always come with a concept, not A to Z or SOP we call it. But I found that it's better this way when they know a frame and they are free to run around within that frame instead of saying, should I go straight or should I turn right?
I see.
So they could become very relaxed in a working environment because they know what atmosphere we want to deliver. And they know we didn't even have a working hour. They come because they know they have to be here. Leave because they think they finished their job and then they can go. So what was the framework there? They become more responsible to their work. So that is quite different. And I think the third is give before they ask. There are a couple of times that we have our staff came into the office and they say, "Chef, I think there's something wrong with my payslip because I got $2,000 extra."
So I said, no, that you started.
You know, you get this $2,000 started from this month. You give before they ask, and that's something that we always do. We appreciate the work, and then we always give before they ask. I think it's at the end of the day, you're still giving out that race, but how they feel is completely different. Whether they get it after they ask, or you just we take the initiative to do it for the staff, and that directly affect how they treat the customer. They would do before they ask.
I see.
Yeah. And so I guess it's a philosophy that we pass on, and how they would think that whenever the guest had a steak, they would need toothpick. And you give before they ask. They would think further. So I think there are a couple of philosophy that we develop at Raw, since we are managing in such a young team, slightly different from other restaurants.
Yeah, it's like Shen Jiao leading by example.
And
how would you say that your team building activities are? And are there like memorable moments from your team building with a young team?
Yes, every year we have a team building. The team building, we go for a survival game.
Like literally shooting at each other.
Shooting at each other. The reason that we did it, it's a tradition since we were in Restaurant Andre in Singapore. And then we passed on to Raw when we first started. I think managing such a big team, it's almost like managing a brigade. So they have the discipline. They live in a big team, big community. So we have this brothership since the beginning. So how to build up this team spirit? Every year we have this survival game, and I often share that we have this Save the President game that we always play. So we split the team into two, and one team will be the terrorism, and the other team will be the good guy.
Defending the president?
Yes.
Who's the president?
I'll be the president.
You're the president. Just checking. Okay.
Yeah, so I'll play the president. And then, so the one team, they would try to go from point A to point B and then try to escort the president to Air Force, and the Air Force one, and then you have a terrorism standby and then ready to shoot him. And so you will see that at that point, you start to develop a strategy. You will see the pastry chef, the pastry girls, and say, "No, you know, let's do this. Let's pretend that it's a fake president, but we're going from this way." And you say, "Wow, you know, you don't see that very often when she's just quietly, piping her vanilla cream on the puff, and then suddenly she become the
tactician."
Exactly. And that was that very interesting part. So since the first year we did that, we thought it's a great practice for our team building. And then so we do that all the time. So what is exactly that president in this whole team building session is our restaurant.
Mm.
So how we protect this restaurant moving towards where we want to go. And then there will be different voices, there will be different challenges, and how we find each other's strength and then get to
mm-hmm.
where we're going. So it's a great practice, and then we have it all the time. Maybe you can try it in the office.
Sounds very interesting. Maybe in virtual reality. Right.
Yes.
So it's nice that you mentioned this lady chef, because my next question is about women's representation.
Yeah.
When I was a child, which is around the same time as you were a child or the same generation, chef is considered kind of a man's world. The culinary arts that we see on newspapers is like 90% man. Has that changed in the next generation? And are there any advice that you would give to women who want to be a chef?
Yes, it is. It changed dramatically.
Mm-hmm.
And previously in Restaurant André, we have more girls than men in our team.
Oh, wow.
Mm-hmm. In Taiwan, at Raw, we have half and half.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Yeah, 48% to 52%.
Excellent.
So we have almost half and half.
Mm-hmm.
I guess nowadays there's no much difference. In fact, I feel that girls, they have much more delicate hands, and especially doing high pressure work, they're extremely calculative and focused.
Mm-hmm.
And why today that we don't see so many female chefs is because a lot of them abandon their career after they get married.
I see.
So we didn't see a lot of female chefs. That's the thing that I feel, you know, being a mom is as important of having a great career. And in an Asian culture, we still think that it's important to you know, support the family. Therefore, we don't see that much female chef really can go through that and even after the marriage and still continue their career. But I do see more and more that we employ a lot of female chefs.
Okay. I think as a society, we're slowly but surely moving toward like helping a child's family together as a society to raise the child. And therefore, hopefully, we'll see more senior women chefs in the future in Taiwan. So the other thing I want to ask you is that you've said that you're proud to be able for the young team to kind of lead the creative direction of the restaurant. And we've seen a lot of creative directions, for example, working with the Web3, Metaverse, NFT, and worlds like that. How did that come about, and how do you feel about this?
Yes, definitely. I feel that we are moving forward, and every creation that marks where we are. Food is just like language. Every generation, we use the same ingredients, but we say it differently.
I see.
Yeah. When you said cool, we said awesome. We said
rad.
Yes. Or sick.
Yep.
You know, then you see a different generation. They use the same vocabulary. They use a different vocabulary, but express the same the same thing. Same as cuisine. I feel that we need to give these young generation more opportunity to show and express themselves and ask questions for them to be more sensitive of the surrounding. We create the first edible NFT. The whole idea is actually pretty simple. If you go to a food court, mm-hmm. you order a curry rice and you get a curry rice mm-hmm. and you eat it, it's yep. good. That's one dimension. Mm-hmm. No talking.
No talking.
The two dimension is when you go to a restaurant and then they will tell you that, oh, this is the scallion from Yilan mm-hmm. and this is the cherry duck from Yilan. Yep. And then the idea of doing this dish was chef thing reminds him about the grandmom's mm-hmm. dish. And then so therefore he created this dish mm-hmm. as you see.
It's a personal memory.
Yes. Mm-hmm. And then you try to put what they said and your dish together and try to create an image or memory, try to connect with that vision. Mm-hmm. That's two dimension. You mm-hmm. hear and then you eat and then you try to imagine. But what is three dimension is what if I can take you to his grandmom's period or I can take you to see his grandmom was cooking this dish. Mm-hmm. And it's not your grandmom or not my grandmom, mm-hmm. it's his grandmom. Mm-hmm. Then we see exactly the same person. We see exactly the same vision. And then we come back to taste the dishes. So now I understand perfectly. Mm. There is no gap of when I said mountain, you think about Fuji Mountain, I think about Alps, you think about something else. Still mountain, but they're different. But what if I can tell you 100% or I take you to that 19th century mm-hmm. or whatsoever, and then you would come back here and then you know exactly what was in his head and why he do this. And that will be no miss. And that's three dimension. So that's where I decide to create, mm-hmm. create this NFT, try to bring people mm-hmm. into a creator's mind. And I think that's the valuable thing about this. And mm-hmm. I'm a dreamer. I don't mind trying new things. And what I think is valuable in this whole process is to tell people that the painting of Van Gogh might be valuable. But if I can get into Van Gogh's mind mm-hmm. and understand that why he painting this, this masterpiece is even more valuable. Mm-hmm. And I try to create this NFT to let people get into the creator's mind and understand why he doing this. Mm-hmm. It's much more valuable than the dish itself.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. All right, so it's a token of connection, really. Between yes. a creator and hopefully someone who will be inspired by the personal memories of the creator and also the context in which the creation was made.
Yes, yes. So imagine if in the Van Gogh time mm-hmm. he released an NFT mm-hmm, mm-hmm. about his creating process. mm-hmm. And today, that thing gonna be more mm-hmm. valuable than, you know, that shows mm-hmm. what he see.
Yep.
Is his vision really twisted or is that just his style? Mm-hmm. That thing will be even more valuable than what he paint.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Because what he painted is just a kind of door through which that we can see the mind. But previously, there was no way to make this direct connection.
Yes.
I think this is super innovative, befit of the innovative minds, Chef. So my last question to you, Andre. You talk about the importance of the mutual appreciation between peers of chefs who have different thoughts, different purposes, rather than just individual-to-individual competition to get X amount of Michelin stars. Mm. So based on the discussion of this kind of new generation of peer appreciation of new generation of chefs, which peers of yours of this generation do you admire and why?
If I would say one, I would say Auguste Escoffier. So Auguste Escoffier is one of the greatest chef in France, and he's the chef that he published so many books, mm-hmm. and to really that chef stand out from the kitchen, mm-hmm. and really made this chef, this occupation become not really a celebrity, but to let people understand and notice about the craft, mm-hmm. That starts from him. And the most important writing from him is he gathers all the best chef at that time in 1938. Mm-hmm. He did a book of La Rousse, so which is the dictionary kind of, like mm-hmm. I mentioned, the Taiwan flavor spectrum, yeah. Book together all the greatest chef and what is French cuisine all about in one big book. And I think that was the great thing, that every single chef in France must have that book, read that book, and then have that book wherever they go. For me, it's always a role model that I look up to. Mm-hmm. I hope I can create a book just like him, and then that could last for a very long time, and then that all the young generation after generation could benefit from what he has established, to put all the elements of DNA of the cuisine and the culture together, and which inspired a lot of great chefs today. That was my the chef that I inspired, admired the most.
Okay, and as you said, you're doing pretty much the same thing in his footsteps with the Taiwan Flavor Spectrum project. Thank you so much, Chef Andre.
Thank you,
for
Audrey.
Coming to our show. And to our audience, please check more information and videos on TaiwanPlus.com. We have a YouTube channel too. So if you like today's episode, be sure to subscribe and share. See you next time. Live long and prosper.
Well, I think it went pretty well. Especially about the Taiwan flavor spectrum, because exactly last year, me and Audrey, I was in her office and we talked about this project already, and then she kind of gave me quite a lot of advice. So it's great that the 1 year later, and then we talk about it again. Also that we had many progress, and this time we have our own Taiwan Flavor Spectrum Lab that we started this year. So it's great to catch up, and then last time we didn't have so much time to talk about, and especially it's in our office, so a bit more official, and this time we feel much more relaxed. Artichoke.
Okay. Artichoke. Is that the
veg? It's a vegetable. Artichoke is a very strong vegetable that it could grow almost everywhere. You kind of don't know. It's kind of like tomato. That is it fruit or is it vegetable?
Okay.
So it can be both. So it's nutritious, but at the same time, it's beautiful, it's strong. I think I'm a person that everything needs to have a reason. Every decision I make, there will be a reason. Therefore, when you make a decision, you don't regret, there's no way back. Also, whenever I make a decision, I think a lot. I learn about the pros and cons. So either it goes in the right direction or wrong direction, I've expected already. I expect that to happen. So you just live with it, and there's no regrets.
Okay.
Well, there's one. There's when I married my wife. We met for 3 months, and then we get married. And I didn't measure the pros and cons. Hi, everyone. I'm André Chiang. I'll see you on Taiwan Plus.